Let's not think about that right now. We'll come to that. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it, inshallah. Inshallah. You see, the thing is that when you begin a surah, particularly a surah like Surah Yusuf, right? So the setup situation is supremely important, that you have the framework set, and that takes time. It's just like when you're building a building. So you have to make sure that your foundation is solid before you move on. Otherwise, you know, it can be pretty here and there in understanding. And particularly the topics that are dealt with in Surah Yusuf are kind of sensitive in a way. So one needs to make sure that you are clearly on the same page about it. Like, for example, yesterday we were talking about homosexuality, and there were these very pertinent questions. So is this a disease? Is this, you know, one might think that this is another thing which is created by God. So rather than leaving it unanswered, you go over all of those tricky things, you know, with as much detail as possible, and then inshallah move on. So then the whole surah is in perspective. And then alhamdulillah, there are certain ayat, and it's like that in all surahs, which may not require that much discussion, really, right? And the whole purpose of doing one surah, and we're actually not doing it for the entire month, we've got 15 days. So if you look at it, Monday to Friday, and then we've got 15 sessions, is the idea that we go into a little bit of depth more than usual. And believe it or not, when you look at the amazing work that the scholars have done, this is still not even the tip of the iceberg, really. Because if you go into each and every word analysis, et cetera, that's pretty time consuming. And that's another level of knowledge, right? Yeah, it depends. Not necessarily, right? Why do we read the Quran? We talked about the purpose right in the beginning. So you tell me if you remember. Basically for Hidayah. And basically in the month of Ramadan, so that we can have a close connection with God. So there's a purpose of why you do things. So if we do, if we are attending a tafsir session, just purely for the sake of knowledge, then that can go to as much depth as possible. So if, say, for example, you're doing a course where you're going to be an alim or something, right? So that means that your knowledge needs to be a lot more, right? So we are not at that level at all, right? We have said that many times in sessions like these, that these are not scholarly sessions at all. These are da'wah sessions. There's a very distinct difference between both. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to get to that level of scholarly. But then when you get to that level of scholarly, then your responsibility also becomes that much more. And alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He gives us the advantage of doing little, but it transforms us, then that is true knowledge. Right? Otherwise, it's again pieces of information. And we talked about it right in the beginning in the introduction, that there are many people in this dunya who are actually scholars of the Quran and they're not even Muslim. And their knowledge of the Quran is probably a lot more than all of us put together. You know, the nuances, the Arabic language, the grammatical analysis, all of that, believe it or not, who are known as Orientalists. And I always find, I admire this woman. Her name is, you know, the one who's written Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not, there's Leslie Hazelton, but this other one. What's her name? Does anybody remember? I've completely forgotten her name.
Karen
Armstrong. That's right. Karen Armstrong. She is like lyrical about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the question is that if she thinks that he is God's gift to mankind truly, then why is she not a Muslim? No, but the fact is, whatever she says, I'm saying I do admire her because her knowledge is great and everything. But the fact is that what scholars tell us is, take your deen from people of deen. Although you might feel that, you know, so-and-so's knowledge is so much more, but there is no iman. So that's, again, piece of information. If Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't impress you enough to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, that he is going to be my role model and he is going to be my guide and he is the one who I'm going to follow, then there is a disconnect. There's something not quite right. Same with this other lady you're talking about. You know, whoever, and there are many, believe it or not, who admire the deen of Islam, who admire what is in the Quran, who are praising Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but there's something not right. That connection is not made. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never ever put us in a situation where we have knowledge but no taqwa. We have knowledge but no haya. We have knowledge but no love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about that in the Quran, that you are then like a gadha, like a donkey who just has books laden and that's it. It doesn't mean anything, really. So just little bit of contemplation, little bit of knowledge, if that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, that's a better deal, right? Okay. So inshallah, as we always, in fact, this could be our reflection for Ramadan, what we just talked about, right? That think about it in these nights. We talked about that before as well. That don't hyperventilate about how much Quran have you done. How much Quran is actually transforming into you. Like for those of us who are attending these sessions and we are doing this one surah, Surah Yusuf, and then, you know, really in the Quran, going over the entire Quran in the month of Ramadan is magical. There's absolutely no doubt about that. Because your hearts are a little soft, you yourself are making a little bit of an effort. So the way it, you know, it's like that rain that is, that kind of falls on you with snow and hail and storm, right? And if that is not happening, because sometimes we hear people saying stuff like that, I'm like, but mere saath to ye nahi hua. Like you feel, don't worry, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, soften my heart, right? There was a time where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, that was in the Madani period, where a delegation came. You know, delegations used to come to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They heard the Quran and they started crying. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, who had the softest heart like a little chiriya, you know, he was just so soft-hearted, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. He said to the other sahaba, he was like so thin. He said, remember, we used to cry like this in the initial days. You know, if Quran does not penetrate, and one short way of knowing whether it is penetrating or not is your eyes cannot remain dry. You are emotionally involved. If your emotions are not involved, then you might as well do physics or chemistry. You know, anybody who does anything in this dunya, even if it is physics or chemistry, right, they are emotionally involved and invested in it. These days, because of all of these fancy YouTubers and influencers, anybody who's on the top of their game, just look at the way they speak. Passion comes through. And passion is what? Emotions. Passion is emotions, right? So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that emotional connect with the Quran so that we have this deep emotional connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, 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 particularly in these nights, right? Okay. So again, before we actually formally begin, just a little recap, right? A scholar once said that you will never be out of Surah Yusuf. One way or the other, you will all go through these trials the way they are mentioned in Surah Yusuf. And that is so true if you think about it. So far, what we've done is, like what happened? First of all, Yusuf alayhi salam is young, and he is apple of his father's eye. And then because of that, he faces severe jealousy and envy from his parents. So we see the sibling rivalry situation, and it goes to that extent that, you know, it's jealousy, envy, hate from his own family, from his own flesh and blood, right? They took him and threw him into a well. He's in this dark place. So he experienced loneliness and fear, unknown future, what's going to happen. He had no idea what's going to happen, yeah? And then when he gets rescued from that situation, he's sold into slavery for a meager price. We saw that, right? Now from being a beloved son of a prophet, he is an absolutely worthless slave, so to speak, in terms of dunya. Yeah? And he's taken to a distant alien land, completely out of his comfort zone. And he grows up in a respectable family, in a respectable household, into a handsome young man. And now he's facing this difficult trial of adulthood that we are talking about right now in these ayat from the woman of the house who is passionately attracted towards him. So all of these trials, and then inshallah we'll go on and we'll see that this is not, it's not over yet, right? All of these trials, according to this particular scholar, in some degree or other, each and every human being goes through, right? And that is the amazing thing about stories of all prophets, that there is a reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned these stories, because they are a reflection of our lives in one way or the other. And particularly with Surah Yusuf, because it's talking about temptations and it's talking about sexual desire, which is something that everybody goes through at some point in time, at some stage or the other. Okay. So now, inshallah, we will begin with Surah Yusuf, ayah number 30. Inna alhamdulillah, ya Rabbi lakal hamdu hatta tarda, wa lakal hamdu idha ma radit, wa lakal hamdu ba'da rida, wa lakal hamdu ala kulli hal. اللهم لك الحمد حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا الحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي آمين يا رب العالمين يا غفور الرحيم يا أرحم الراحمين يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. So we had reached the point of the story where the husband finds out, right? And there is a witness. And the husband says to the wife that you should seek astaghfar. And to Yusuf alayhi salam, let it go, forget about it. So what does that mean? What does that mean? Let's open the ayah. What that means is that Yusuf alayhi salam is actually back to his duties, right? Because the husband said, chodo chodo, you know, forget about it. So it's not as if he has been discharged of his duties or sent outside or to, you know, work in the fields or anything like that. No, he's very much there. He's very much there. And then the women of the city begin speaking, right? There's some gossip going on, right? And despite the attempts of Aziz to keep the matter hush-hush, remember we talked about it that he didn't want scandal because of his reputation, news spreads. And this is the thing with news, with gossip and slander and innuendo, that people just love to spread it. Yeah, they just love to spread it. And how did people find out? The scholars say it was from the household of the woman, definitely. Right? It was not Yusuf alayhi salam. It was not the wife, and it was not Aziz, and it wasn't even the Shahid, the witness from her family. And other slaves must have found out, or other people in the household. And scholars say is that, please remember that this woman was lusting after Yusuf alayhi salam for quite a while, right? So perhaps her lust and her affections were so obvious that people kind of figured out that this is what is going on, right? So, again, one thing that we need to focus on in this ayah, according to scholars, is this whole idea about gossip, right? How it is a curse in societies, and very much so in our society as well, right? Every society is immersed in gossip, right? Yani, for example, we have these cell phone ads. Have you noticed what their taglines are? Or sunao, right? But you sunao, chup bhi to raho kabhi, right? It's always about, like, you know, let's talk. And I remember some years ago, there was this particular ad, I don't remember which company, it was actually saying, so two women are talking to each other saying, so what's the gossip? What's the latest gossip? Tell me about it, right? How many of you talk to your moms, like, regularly? My mom is. Or your sisters, so you talk to her all the time? Alhamdulillah. Your sisters or a best friend or somebody, right? Yeah, you don't talk regularly, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. One of the most dangerous things in our society is Mummy Day. You know, we have this concept of Mummy Day. Those of you who don't have it, say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Because that is the time where you feel that I need to, you know, sharing is caring. No, it is not. If it is gossip. You're talking about everybody under the sun. You're talking about your sisral. You're talking about so-and-so. I met so-and-so. And this happened. And before you know it, you're slipping into all kinds of conversations about other people that you really shouldn't be. Right? Which is ghibah, really. So according to our Islamic understanding, there are three things that we need to be careful about. Right? One is ghibah. And the definition of ghibah that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given is backbiting is what? That you say about somebody behind their back something which is true. Something which is true. So when a sahabi said that, Ya Rasulullah, if what I'm saying is something which my brother has, so Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that is when it's ghibah. If you say something which he doesn't have, if you're making up a story, that is bohtan, that is slander, and that is kabira guna. That is, it has a had punishment, actually, slander, right? So that is a completely, you're going into another league if you are making up stories, right? Like she did. She made up a story. She slandered Yusuf alayhi salam, right? So this is something that we need to be so, so very careful about, that we should not really be tolerating any kind of gossip. And gossip is something which has its own enjoyment. A lot of times people say that if we don't talk about people, what do we talk about? You know, all of, and particularly, and we should not be offended because we are mostly women over here, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has specifically speaks about women in Surah Hujurat separately. This is in the Quran. Because we do. I'm not saying that men don't gossip. They do. But women have a tendency of gossiping more. Whether it is related to your workplace, whether it is related to your children's teachers, whether it's related to relatives or friends or whoever. And another very sorry state of affairs is that we feel anybody who's in a public thing, like for example, a celebrity or a politician or whatever, we can say whatever we want about them. That's free game, free for all situation. No, it's not. Why do you need, you see, criticism of somebody's policy is one thing, right? Gossiping about their personal matter is a completely different thing. Or going overboard about that, you know, so-and-so is like that. And so why, how do you know that? How do you know that? For all you know, and for all you know, with that piece of riba, you're also adding slander to it. That, you know, and a lot of journalism today is based on that, gossip and slander. We need to be very, very careful about what news we consume as well, because we would be part of that system then, yeah? So that is, this was exactly what was going on over here, right? And various different ahadiths about riba. Riba would be, is a sin which will be punished in the qabr as well. It will be one of the reasons for the azab-e qabr. Right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. And then worse than that is buhtan. Is slander, when riba means you're telling the truth. Right? I remember this very sweet lady, very cute. She had no idea about the definition of riba. Right? She said, oh, but what I'm saying is a true story, na? Yes, it is a true story. That is why it is riba. Right? And there are people who, because some definitions say that you say in front, you would not be, you wouldn't say this, that thing in front of the person. So people say, I don't care. I would say it to her face. So that means not only are you doing riba, but you're also rude and batamiz. You know, you're adding to that, that you're so batamiz that you would say it to her face or his face, right? So we need to be super, super careful about that. And then this third thing, which is called namima, which is tattletale. This is also like, say, for example, somebody said something about Kulsoom to Sara, right? And Sara comes running to Kulsoom and says, Kulsoom Aba, you know, so-and-so was saying this about you. Absolutely true. But was there any need for her to say this to me? Because she knows, kind of, or should know better, that it will upset me. It will be something which is not going to be like, you know,
I'm not going to be happy about it. Nobody wants to hear bad things about themselves or something, you know. And she's like, oh, no, no, I think she should know that so-and-so is such and such type of person. That is namima. And that is also absolutely forbidden in our deen. Right? So you are in a gathering and somebody said something, you overhear it, the other person is not there, and you make it a point that you related to the other person that this was going on about you in that particular instance. So what we learn from the sunnah is that the least you can do is remain silent and feel bad in your heart about it, that this is not a good thing. The best thing would be to stop it there. You know, talking about the weather, you know, I think one of the things that we should learn from the English people is talk about the weather. We really need to practice benign and interesting topics and subjects that we can talk about. And unfortunately, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions women, particularly in Surah Hujarat, a lot of the times women are just have too much free time, are not involved in productive activities, right? They're not a lot of times. And I'm talking about women who are privileged, actually. The woman who comes and cleans my house or cooks for me, she doesn't have time. She's got so much going on. Although, unfortunately, she gossips as well. Right? And perhaps she's learned it from you. Because if there's one person in our culture, particularly, who's working for the Devrani and the Jitani and the Saas, so she's going to go around everywhere telling things about this. That's a very... And then why is she so comfortable saying it to you? Because you're also very inquisitive. So what is going on in upstairs? Or in that room, or in the other house, or whatever. Right? So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us about namima, that the one who does this will not enter Jannah. These are serious things. This is nothing to overlook. So alhamdulillah, at least this should be a reason that we should be involved in productive stuff. That all of those WhatsApp groups that we have, yeah. And now these days our fingers are an extension of our tongues. So don't think that you say, oh, I didn't say it, I typed it. So don't kid yourself about technical details like that, right? So if we are involved in, alhamdulillah, pursuit of knowledge, social work, gardening, cooking, I don't know, it could be anything. And there are so many things, alhamdulillah, one must say, that people are involved in these days as well. Talk about that. It'll be, even if it's say for entertainment's sake, and not 100% beneficial, but we have to have mechanisms within ourselves and practice not to gossip, not to slander. When gossip becomes slander, it takes a second, right? And not to do this thing, namima. So-and-so said this, you know, we were meeting, you know, you weren't there, you didn't come to the kitty party, and so-and-so was saying this about you. G, you have a question? Okay, just understand one thing. That's a very good question. You are saying that if a person has done this and you make a safar, so will you be forgiven until and unless you go and apologize to the person? If you have usurped a human being's rights, and riba is one of that, that you, on slander is one of that, and namima is one of that, that you have done zulm on that person. So his right was to be respected, and you didn't do that, right? So yes, you should apologize. But what scholars say is that the maghfirah of Allah and the mercy of Allah is so vast that you make, and we are basically puny, you know, ninnies. So if you do not find it in yourself to go and apologize, and if you feel that an apology might worsen the situation in the relationship, particularly we talk about, like, say, daughter-in-law and mother-in-law, say, for example, and it might be construed as not being sincere, but another little drama that you're doing. So sincerely repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and make dua for the person that you have wronged. That's the least that one can do, and have absolute faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Ya Allah, I'm just too weak. I don't have the guts to go and say sorry to that person. Say, for example, ideal situation would be yes, sincerely, but make sure that try to make up in some way. Be extra nice.
You should be nice anyways, right? Maybe send a gift or something. So there are various little things that you can do, and then make it a point to make dua for that person on a regular basis, right? Because you have wronged that person, you have harmed that person, right? And then constant astaghfar with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, constant tawbah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, this is a beautiful hadith, he said to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, that if you promise to guard what is between your cheeks and what is between your legs, I promise you a house in the middle of Jannah. And these are the two things we are talking about in Surah Yusuf. Guarding of the tongue and guarding of your privates. Right? These, you know, sins of the tongue are also part of that flame we were talking about, him, that passion that sometimes you find it so hard. I have to tell someone, I have to tell someone. Right? You really need to, that's also a very toxic passion that we have. Just to talk. And the more you talk, the more likelihood of talking rubbish. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the one who keeps quiet has made it, gets salvation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man of few words. He didn't go on and on and on and on. And again, unfortunately, what is being said to us in the name of confidence is that if you can't hold your own in a conversation, or if you can't just keep babbling on, that means that you are underconfident, right? Underconfident is one thing, and being like a obsessive verbal diarrhea person is another thing. It's a bad idea, because the more you speak, you know, the more you post, God knows what garbage you're going to end up posting, right? So restrict yourself, right? That is called hilm. We need to have that helm, that ability to control ourselves. And that is something to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, right? And we know that among the Sahaba, there were some who had issues, you know, we'll inshallah, if we come to tazkiyah, inshallah, had, but they worked on themselves to stop doing. For example, Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he had a loud voice. So when he used to speak, he was a very powerful orator also, right? And then there's a verse in the Quran that do not raise your voice ahead of Rasul. And he was like petrified. What should I do? Right? So if Allah has given you a natural tone, which is higher than others, that doesn't mean that you're raising your voice. But then even then try to soften it a little bit. If you've got feedback from people who say that too loud, yeah, too harsh. Maybe you didn't even mean it. And then you know, if you have an ego problem, what are you going to say? Do whatever, that's how I speak, right? But if you are somebody who's serious about your purification of the heart, then you're going to say, okay, I'll work on it. I'll see how I can sort of minimize my garishness, so to speak. So these problems are one of those, right? So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say that what is going on around? This gossip and this rumoring is going around, right? So when she hears this, the wife, right, about their covert agenda, she sent for them. And she's prepared for them a place to recline, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when she heard of their taunting comments, she extended an invitation to them and arranged for them a comfortable place and gave everyone a knife. Okay, let's talk up to here and then we'll go forward. And who is she? She is she's the wife of a minister, of a big shot man, right? So when she sends an invitation, you go or you don't go? Of course you go. In fact, you are worried if you're not invited. What happened? Is my husband out of favor now? Because I'm not invited, right? So she prepared this banquet, right? And obviously each and every one of them came. Huh? And because there was a purpose for her inviting them, so she gives each and every one of them a knife, right? So what scholars say is that perhaps she hadn't planned it, that they're going to cut their hands or something, but perhaps she was serving certain food which requires a knife. Like, you know, you need a steak knife or you need knife to cut fruit, etc. and all. And then she said to Yusuf alayhi salam, show yourself, come forward. And remember, Yusuf alayhi salam is back to his duties. So she's the mistress. So he can't refuse. So he comes, right? And what scholars say is, so they saw him and they found him great
and were so stunned that they cut their hands. And they said, oh God, he's no human being. He can be nothing but a noble angel, right? And what scholars say is that they didn't kind of cut their hands, like severed their hands, but there's any like sort of a slit or something or whatever. And there are other scholars who say that not all of them did that. One of them cut their hands. So Yusuf alayhi salam came to bandage and whatever, and then all of them cut them deliberately. Yeah, that's one interpretation of one scholar. Both could be correct. Wallahu alam, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given us these details in the Quran, right? And when you look at this whole banquet scenario, that she has called them particularly to taunt them, because you were making fun of me, look at him. This is the prize, yeah? So that goes to show that she hadn't really made astaghfar at all. You know, she was still there, right? Hari Baba, Hari Bukku. She hadn't. Right? Yusuf alayhi salam moved on. She's still there. She says, I'm not going to let go that easy. Yeah. What is that saying? Hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. It's that kind of a situation, right? Then in ayah number 32, acha, something, a little side point over here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions makar, the word makar here in this ayah. Right? It means do something covertly with the intent to harm someone. So the makar of the women was what? That they should harm the Aziz's wife. And in ayah number 28, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Aziz was mentioning the qaid of the women, which doesn't necessarily have to have an element of secrecy in it. So that's a little fine difference between makar and qaid. Okay. Right. And then she says, this is the one about whom you reproach me. You know, she's kind of taunting them now. Yes. And imagine the lack, zero lack of, no haya, right? Yes, I seduced him. She's saying it in public, in front of all these women, right? That, yeah, I seduced him, right? And he abstained. She's saying that also, right? And then she goes on to say that I am going to do this again. And if he doesn't listen to my command, then he will certainly be imprisoned and he will be disgraced. He will be, you know, as wala yakunam minas shagirin. Shagir is somebody small, somebody who is degraded and humiliated. And scholars say that she's using this specific word because she herself was disgraced, na? When she was found out and people are making fun of her about it kind of situation. But look at the, you know, that word in Urdu cannot be translated in English. She's so dheet. What would dheet be in English? Stubborn doesn't bring that connotation of dheet. Stubborn is too soft. Dheet is like, do whatever. I'm going to do this again. That is dheet. You know, that we become dheet in the disobedience of Allah. That's another problem with passions and temptations. It makes you the level of stubborn that you like devil may care attitude, you know, that kind of thing. You literally sell your soul to the devil. It becomes like that. She has no haya, no respect for even her husband or the position, that nothing. You forget about everything. You're like, no, I'm going to do this again. And if he doesn't listen this time, then he's going to prison. That's what's going to happen, right? And then look at Yusuf alayhi salam. Right? Yusuf alayhi salam is right there. This dialogue is happening in front of him, right? And not he realizes that she hasn't given up at all, right? In fact, she has lost all shame, and she is publicly announcing to all her friends or the women who were there, right? First, at least she wanted to conceal. Now even that little haya is gone, right? And that is what's the problem with sins and with passions. If you don't control them, that you go further down the spiral, like we've been saying every day. So now she is openly saying that. So Yusuf alayhi salam, I didn't change over here. All right. Then Yusuf alayhi salam is hearing all this. And Yusuf alayhi salam says, Master, prison is more beloved to me from whatever they are calling me towards. And if you don't remove me away from their plan, I will give in to them and I will be counted among those who are swayed by their emotions, right? Now, Yusuf alayhi salam is now looking at the situation that it is actually compounded. How? Because first it was just this one woman. Now these other women are after, women are after him as well. So for all you know, after she's done with him, the others might be kind of, you know, the way, the kind of reaction that he saw in this whole gathering. So he is saying that, my Lord, O Allah, prison is, I love prison. He's not just saying, send me to prison. He's saying, I love ahabba ilayya. Qala rabbi sijnu ahabbu ilayya. Ahab is from hub, which is love, right? That's much more beloved to me than getting involved in this filth and in this sin and in, you know, in these kind of activities, right? And then some scholars say that the reason that he's using a plural over here is, yad'unani, the plural over here is, because all of these women are now witness to her intentions and they felt that she's absolutely justified in doing this and they would probably encourage her as well. You know, so all of these things are going on at this time, right? And this shows Yusuf alayhi salam's piety and purity. He was a prophet of God. He had haya. He had taqwa. He had the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his heart. So he says, I'd rather lose my freedom, right? I'd rather not see sunlight. I'd rather eat prison food. I'd rather that I don't know what's going to happen to me in future. Prison is not a very pretty place to be in, by the way. Yeah, it's not like, okay, so you're just a hotel room or something. No. He says, all of that I would rather endure than get involved in this sin. This is such a huge, huge lesson for all of us, and particularly for young men and young women, right? So, and what one scholar said was so beautiful, because we talked about it, that we can have this kind of passion online as well. That perhaps you're attracted to something, you know, of a sexual nature online, whether it's a movie or a movie star or something, you know, a celebrity or whatever, you know, whatever. And may Allah save us from ever being involved with pornography, right? But just in case, this what scholar says is that even if it is virtual, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that, and we turn away and say that I would rather, you know, no. And remember, we did that hadith that a person who's called to sin by a beautiful and noble woman, and he says, no, thank you, I fear Allah, and he's going to be under the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's shade. So in the context of that hadith, the scholar was saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that strength as well to say no. Why? Simply because I fear Allah. Because I fear Allah, no other repercussions. I don't care about my reputation. I don't care about anything. It's just that I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the fear of God. And and then what scholars tell us is that what was Yusuf alayhi salam's prison? A physical prison, right? First, let's have a look at this word that he's saying, right? Al-shab, which is attraction. And the root meaning of that is to be childish. Why being childish? Because children have no idea about or don't care about consequences, or are not aware of the consequences of certain actions. You know, little children, they're going to play with matches and stay without realizing that what the consequence of doing that is, right? So this is one word which is important in this ayah. And then his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, accepted his prayer and turned their guile away from him. Surely, innahu huwa samiul alim, he is the all-hearing and all-knowing. Right? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala heard what Yusuf alayhi salam is saying. And then what happens to him? We'll talk about what happens when he goes to prison. But before that, the thing important that we need to talk about is, yesterday we talked about how to resist temptations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about a very specific temptation in these incidents, which is zina. Yeah. What scholars tell us is that the disastrous effects of zina are not just spiritual, but also social and also psychological. So what scholars say is that if you are involved in zina, whether it is heterosexual
or homosexual. Homosexual is worse because you are doing something which is against your nature, right? And you're saying that this is from Allah, which it is not, right? Your deen will go down. Your taqwa will go down. Your ikhlas will go down. Your haya will most certainly out of the window completely. Salah will go down. Yeah, your ability to do dua will go down. Right? So whatever acts of worship that you may have will be disintegrated, really. And for a person who is careful or cares about or prioritizes their faith, this is a big deal. This is not something small that you lose your faith. And then the second thing, your ilm of deen will go down. Your knowledge will go down. There will be no barakah in your ilm, right? And you may forget the knowledge that you already have. A lot of times, don't we say that, you know, the songs that you heard when you were like 10 years old, you still remember, but it is so difficult to memorize the Quran. Think about it. Why? Yeah, think about it, right? It doesn't come easy. It is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And then scholars say that you will lose your intelligence. What intelligence? The wisdom and fiqh, understanding of things. You just won't get it. A lot of times you read the Quran, you're like, what is being said? It's not rocket science, but you just don't get it. There's a barrier. It's like a barrier. And this lack of haya and this being involved in zina is that barrier, right? A very, very serious barrier. So Allah subhanahu, and then scholars also say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decrease barakah in your risk. And risk is not just what you get to eat and money, but risk is everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Decrease in the barakah of your memory, for example. And some scholars even say that you will lose noor on your face, right? If you keep indulging in it and do not make tawbah, right? What happens is that you will start disliking people of taqwa. You will get allergic to people who want to be keep themselves chaste. Who want to keep themselves pure, who want to have a level of haya, whether it is them covering themselves physically, like women who cover themselves, alhamdulillah, because that is a commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or men who lower their eyes and don't just stare at you, or even women who lower their eyes. I remember many years ago, I met this young man, he was probably 19 years old, and alhamdulillah, we had this whole conversation, but believe it or not, he didn't rate, and I'm sort of old enough to be his mother, right? He did not look at me straight in the face. I was so impressed. I'm talking about this recently. Young teenager. And very respectfully and a very intelligent conversation. And we were even kind of joking a little bit, but he and not that he was sitting like that. You know, one doesn't have to be stupid about things, right? But he did not. And I actually consciously noticed that because it was so pleasant because you generally don't come across people like that. And yet had this whole amazing, wonderful conversation, alhamdulillah, right? And we see that around us, unfortunately. The kind of flack, the kind of jokes, the kind of memes, the kind of crass jokes that are spread around and sometimes said face to face for women who wear hijab, for women who wear niqab, is unbelievable. Where is all that coming from? You become allergic to people of deen. And you don't know what the state of her heart is anyway, but just the obvious thing is like, oh yeah, so, you know, sometimes if you go to a wedding or something and you have been told that it's a segregated wedding, but then you have waiters and things who come and serve and you get desperate and you sort of start covering the people, tumhi ko to dekhna hai. You know, that's a very common thing. I'm not even joking. And it's very pain. And just because people smile, women smile and let go of it doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt in the heart. It's very hurtful. It's very hurtful, right? So you're like, what is this? You know, what, you know, so people are like, they say it to your face all the time. That irritation that you feel. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. Whether you are covering yourself or not, never, ever, ever make fun or think lowly of or whatever of a person who is covering. She is fulfilling the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember that, and you are not. And that is a big deal. That is a big deal. And a lot of times you get this. Oh, you know, I don't go to religious classes because she ends up talking about parda.
Well, if there are women sitting, how can you not end up talking about parda? This is stupid, right? How can you not end up talking about riba, for example? How can you not do that? It's a commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So if they keep indulging in it, then what scholars say is that nauzubillah, ultimately it can go as far as having animosity towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. They get, don't talk to me about God. Just talk about anything. Shuru ho gayi phir, you know, I don't want to talk about this. I don't want to talk religion. Right? People say that. People say that on social media as well. So what scholars say is that may Allah save us from that. This is how far the sin of zina can go in terms of ruining our faith and spirituality completely. Zero. Yeah. Now we need to be, as believers, as believing women and believing men, totally clear about Islamic sexual ethics. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran, hang on, let me just bring the ayat on that. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَ وَسَاءَ السَّبِيلَ. Do not even go near zina, let alone do it. Don't even go near it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has talked about certain activities which he has said categorically in the Quran, specifically about zina in many places. Don't even go near it. And all of the injunctions of God related to haya, related to dress code, related to social etiquettes, are so that all of avenues of zina can be blocked before. There's a rationale behind it. It's not random. It's not just random, right? So when you have hijab of the body, you also have hijab of your attitude. You also have haya in your eyes, right? It's very, very important. And we need to be confident that all of these ethics that Allah has given us related to zina, right, are for our benefit and in the best interest of not just our personal lives, but also for society at large. And today, need we even have a discussion about what corruption is going on around us because of this unchecked zina? Right? And that is also a sociological fact, that the brunt of this is borne by women more than by men, actually. That's a fact. Who ends up holding the baby, for example? Yeah. We can make a compelling case, you and I, for why Islamic sexual ethics are rationally and ethically viable compared to, say, liberal secular alternative. Yeah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that Allah has written for the son of Adam his portion of adultery, which he will inevitably commit. The adultery of the eyes is a lustful look. The adultery of the tongue is lustful speech. The soul craves and yearns, and the private parts either affirm or deny. So every time you wonder why we should not be watching certain things or why we should not be listening to certain lyrics, is because that is zina of the eyes and zina of the ears. And in today's day and age, in rap culture or whatever, etc., filth is being spewed. It's actually filth. Terrible language, right? So one needs to be very, very careful about this, right? One can't stress more. And for us to go into prison would be to leave the environment of sin. Yeah? And adopt some seclusion if we have to, right? You may have to isolate yourself from those social gatherings that you are invited to. Yeah? Even if you feel you're strong enough, what is this story telling us? That you are never strong enough. You just aren't. You can't. You should prefer that isolation to that company that invites you to sin. And another group of young men comes to mind. The young men of Surah Kahf, who chose the isolation and the dismal, you know, they ran away to a cave rather than be exposed to the filth that was in front of them. To save what? To save their iman. If iman is precious to you and me, then we will make these efforts. Then we are going to be very conscious that, am I giving up my iman, right? And in another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that from among the signs of the hour, the end of time, religious knowledge will be taken away. Ignorance will prevail. Right? Jahiliya, all kinds of things of jahiliya. Drinking of alcoholic drinks will be prevalent, and there will be prevalence of zina. We are living in these times. We are actually living in these times. And how can you and I be so comfortable that I can do without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection? I can do without the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I can do without the sunnah of Yusuf alayhi salam. In this regard, the sunnah of Yusuf alayhi salam is amazing. He chose not, he didn't just choose, he said, I would love to be in prison. So for that young woman and that young man, stay in your dorm room, right? Or stay at home. That's the only thing that you can do, actually. Without that, you will be in trouble. That's just it. So how is it that you and I, first of all, be absolutely confident about the fact that what our deen and what our Allah is telling us about sexual ethics is the best possible option, not just for me, but for everybody. Promote haya. Promotion of haya is very important. Everybody has become very crass and open and crude. The promotion of haya everywhere. Whether if you're active on social media, perhaps on social media, in gatherings, etc. Look at yourself in the mirror and see how much work do I need to do on myself in terms of my appearance haya. Haya is of many different forms. One is appearance, one is inside of you. What is it that I watch? Begin with yourself and then promote it big time. Promote it big time. And like my teacher always used to give this example that if you see a toothpaste ad, and you know, and this model is smiling and she has rotten teeth, are you ever going to buy that toothpaste?
No.
So try to be a role model for your own children, right? The same thing, na, like parents love to see that, oh, no, this movie is not for you. So a child might ask and they don't, alhamdulillah, so it's okay for you, amma, right? So all of these things, promote haya. That is one thing that we can do, inshallah ta'ala, right? Absolutely 100% never give in to any ideology that says premarital sex, extramarital sex, homosexuality is okay. Don't ever give in to that, no matter how much pressure you feel. That is the least we can do, actually. The least we can do is that, right? So it will be asked from us that you were sitting there, so much was going on. What did you do? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that for a believer, right, if you see something wrong, remove it with your hands, right? Remove it with your hands if you can, or say something about it with your tongue, right? Or at least feel bad about it in your heart, and that is the least level of iman. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our iman, that we are actively involved in promoting haya and promoting the sunnah culture of responsible sexuality. We need to know about it. We need to know what the other person is saying. And we need to know what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said. We need to know what Surah Yusuf is saying, what Yusuf alayhi salam, the strategies that he has taught us, right? Okay. Then in ayah number 35, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now.
In ayah number 34, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him and he put, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the guys away. So he ended up in prison, no? That's what happened. He wanted to be there because he said that's the, because she said, nah, if you're not going to listen to me, I will make sure that you are put into prison. He said, I would love to go in prison. So in ayah 35, we see that later on, even after having seen the clear signs of innocence, they deemed it proper to imprison him for some time. And who is they over here in this ayah? It is the people, the ministers, the aziz, all of these guys. Right? Because their reputation is going to be at stake, because now it is not just one person's wife, but so many wives who are involved in this lustful activity for Yusuf alayhi salam. So they're like, let's put him into jail and let matters cool down. You know, all this gossip will die down, etc. Don't we see that in our society? Something happens or whatever, let it cool down, you know, it's okay. And then you go back to square one, actually. That's the tragedy, right? So let the household of Aziz kind of regain their dignity, right? And then this was kind of a way to suppress the scandal also. Let's put him in jail. So they actually put Yusuf alayhi salam in jail. Now from ayah number 36, we see, yeah.
Sometimes we feel that we are deprived of something, but actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting us. Yes, that is a beautiful reflection. Because it's like being in prison, right? And sometimes it happens with Allah's protection and you haven't really made dua for it or made an effort for it, but Allah actually deprives you. Say, for example, you get sick and are unable to go to the prom. And you might feel like, what? Yeah, it's a possibility. I guess too ill to go to the prom. Or you know, and you're like, but Allah has saved you, God knows from what. Right? So yes, alhamdulillah, that's a very interesting observation also and a reflection that sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy works in ways that we don't understand. Right? There was this story which I want to share because Uzma has mentioned this, that there was this king and he had a minister who had an advisor who was very favorite advisor. And the advisor always used to say that whatever Allah does is for the best, right? And whatever happens. So they were going to hunting. They were going to go hunting and the king cuts off his finger. You know, maybe cutting fruit or whatever, something, he literally cuts off his finger. And the minister and the advisor says, whatever Allah does is best. So the king was like, what are you talking about? I've cut my finger, I've hurt myself so badly. And you're saying, whatever Allah does is best, throw him in prison. So he's thrown into prison and they go off for the hunt. They meet a group of cannibals, right? And the cannibals eat everybody up except the king because he was defected. His finger was cut. And then he goes back to his advisor and says, yes, whatever Allah does is for the best. Yeah. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. That is the mercy of our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So although these guys actually knew pretty well what the deal was with Yusuf alayhi salam, but they still put him in prison. Now, where is he? Yusuf alayhi salam is in prison. Exactly how that happened, etc., all of the details Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given us. But what Allah is saying is that two inmates entered the prison with him. One of them says to him, I have seen that I was juicing wine. And the other said, I see myself carrying above my head some bread. The birds are eating from it. Can you inform us of the interpretation of these confusing dreams? We see you among those who are excellent. Right? Now, two young men enter prison with Yusuf alayhi salam. Huh? The details are not in the Quran, but what we know from the Old Testament is that one was a baker and the other one was a wine presser, and both of them were catering for the king. And they were imprisoned because their enemies had accused them of trying to poison the king. Okay. So they tell him their dream. One of them says that I have a dream that I'm pressing grapes. And now the interesting thing is that why do they tell him his dream? You don't just meet somebody and say that, okay, you know, I think that you're a Mohsin and I think you look like a person who will be able to figure out dreams. How did that happen, right? How did that happen? What scholars say is that the reason they approach him, number one, we don't know if they said that immediately. They're together, right? Right, they're together. Some scholars have said that one of them was because he was a baker. So one of them was assigned the duty of baking bread in the prison and he would bring food to Yusuf, you know, like he would to all of the prisoners. And majority of the scholars say that Yusuf alayhi salam, because he is a truly righteous prophet, right? And he is used to taking care of people who are hurt, who are sick, who are depressed, right? Or just soothing other people. Generally, right? He has that in him as a person, as a prophet, most certainly. So he was doing all of that in prison. He wasn't just sitting there getting depressed, or he wasn't just sitting there in a corner doing his salah or making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was involved with the other prisoners. And prison is not a pretty place. Prison is a place where people are criminals. And perhaps some are in there because of no fault of their own, or they've been accused falsely, like Yusuf alayhi salam. And perhaps these two, we can't say for sure, but perhaps these other two. But Yusuf alayhi salam most certainly. And we know that that happens, that there are many people who are falsely accused and they end up in prison. And even if they are prisoners, they're still human beings. They still need care, right? They are in there for a purpose, that they are serving a term for their crime. That doesn't mean that they should be treated inhumanly, right? So Yusuf alayhi salam must have been helping out, must have been there for people,
right? And the definition of a true salih person is that you have made good your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have made good your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation. So a truly righteous person, and he's a prophet of God, would be what? Soft towards people, soft towards animals also. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the softest of hearts, right? It is said about him that even if little children would come and hold his hand, you know, such a busy person, prophet and leader and everything, he would just walk, take, go around with them wherever they took him. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? He was like that. He had a very, very soft heart. If he would hear anybody in trouble, anybody sad, he would cry. He would actually cry because he had such a soft heart. We know about Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, right? That amazing story. Somebody shared it on Facebook the other day as well, which was really cool. Is that Abu Bakr, this was after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Bakr is the Khalifa. So you can imagine if he's the Khalifa, how much responsibility he has. Just like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had so much responsibility as a prophet. But he still found time to, you know, do things for people, help people out, etc. So Abu Bakr and Umar were always in this competition. Always. And Umar was always on the lookout. What is he doing now? So after Fajr, he used to go a little outside of Medina and enter into a tent. And he would be spying on the home. Umar would be spying, and let's see what happens. That once he, after, and then he would be there for a while and then he would leave. Once Umar followed, after Abu Bakr left, he went in the tent and there was a blind woman there. And she said, who is this person who comes? She said, I have no idea. He just comes every day. She didn't know. He did say, I am Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the Khalifa of the Muslims. He would just come, he would do her housework, and he would leave. She had no idea, right? Then after a bit, Umar radiallahu ta'ala an started doing the same thing after Abu Bakr passed away. And he was the Khalifa. Umar was the Khalifa. And he got her dates one day. And she said, has your friend passed away? I said, how did you know? He said, because you didn't take the pits out of the dates. Imagine, that is taqwa. That is righteousness. So can we imagine Yusuf alayhi salam being any less? He's a prophet of Allah. So that is how they knew that this is a guy to reckon with. This is a guy who's going to help us a little bit, right? They could see that, right? So, and the other thing is that dreams are something, we're not going to talk about dreams again because we've talked about that in great detail before. There are secrets hidden in some of the dreams, yeah? And they could tell that this is a person of knowledge. This is a person of wisdom because of the way he was, right? And they had confidence in him so that they confided in him. So what scholars say is that this is such a beautiful thing about Yusuf alayhi salam, that it is a lesson for all of us. If you are truly righteous, then people draw towards you. Even in today's day and age, if you have, we talk about the empathy. There's a lot of conversation around that, right? If it is not lip service, and if it is true empathy, and if it's true care for others, people will draw to you. That's a fact. People come with their problems or whatever, right? And we should make it a point that we practice that empathy. For example, if I feel I don't have that in me. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made us all very privileged. We have people who work for us in our homes, right? Sit them down, talk to them about their problems. Sometimes they have nobody to talk to. Nobody, you know, and a lot of times these women who work in other people's home have got desperately sad lives. You know, abusive husbands, abusive family, drug addiction, all kinds of issues. All kinds of issues, and poverty is the least of them, actually, to be honest. So sometimes you're very happy in giving money and grow, alhamdulillah, keep doing that as well, to help out, to support. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us that advantage, that upper hand in that situation, that we have people working for us and we are not working in another's home. So yes, most certainly give them their salary, which is fair, right? The minimum wage of a unskilled worker in Pakistan these days is, I think, 20,000? 25, right? Okay. So see what the hours are and see if you're paying the minimum wage. Sometimes we pride ourselves in saying, oh, you know, I got this made for 16,000 rupees. Oh my goodness. And if you did, then you're doing zulm. You're a zalim, right? You go out to eat and you spend 15,000 rupees on a meal, right? And if you can't afford it, then don't keep. It's as simple as that. Or keep for a few hours or whatever. Alhamdulillah, that's not an issue, right? But alhamdulillah, we are all from that strata of society. Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have our hisab easy, that we have people who are working for us. It is our unwritten responsibility to look after their needs, to look after their family, educate their children. We can do it. It's not a dent on our pocket even. And even if it is, say for example, even if it is, what should we do? This is a month of Ramadan particularly. What should we do? Should we always give something which is left over? Always give something which is not really worth it? No. And the fact that you just sit with someone, hold their hand and talk to them. Many times in this dunya, that is all that people need. That is one therapy that you can do without being a therapist. Just hold their hand and listen to them. You can't do anything to change their situation, perhaps. You can't. So you can't give them this whole lecture about your husband is so cruel and all, leave him. Let me take you to a divorce lawyer. I mean, that's unrealistic and stupid, actually. Where is she going to do? Oh, there's too many situations going on. But you can most certainly hold her hand, sit her down with you. Yeah, not on the floor, but with you. And, you know, just listen to her story. Yeah, be truly empathetic towards her. Or, and perhaps you will be in a position to give a very good advice as well. So these are the things. Can you imagine so many little side points we learn from the stories in the Quran? Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. So they must have seen him to be that kind of a person. So they approached him, right? Achha ji. Then in ayah number 37, what is Yusuf alayhi salam saying? Yusuf alayhi salam didn't immediately give them the interpretation of the dream. Although he probably, what scholars say is, that he probably knew. But he immediately didn't, right? He said to them, no food provided for you shall come to you. But I can give you its description before it comes to you. This is the knowledge my Lord has given to me. I have abandoned the way of those who do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who are deniers of the hereafter. Then in ayah 38, he says, we'll do these two ayahs and then we'll see what it means. And I have followed the way of my fathers, Ibrahim, Ishaq, and Yaqub, alayhim as-salam. It is not for us that we associate any partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All this is a part of the favor Allah has bestowed upon us and upon the people, but most of the people are not grateful, right? So what Yusuf alayhi salam, because he's a Nabi and he's a prophet, he is a da'i, he saw this as a window of opportunity to talk to these people about God, to preach Islam to them, right? In the most beautiful, in the most simple way. Not too much, right? Not too much. And he's also respecting their time. So he's saying when food comes, you know, we're going to be on a break. Usually in prisons, people have duties and all as well, right? Everybody's sitting together and eating. So that is a great time for da'wah that we can, you know, that is the time we can utilize while we are eating and we can talk about what you have asked me. And then he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me this ability, has given this mercy to me. Yeah. And after saying that, he says that I do not follow. Inni taraktu millata qaumin la yu'minuna billahi wa hum bil akhirati hum kafirun. Right? I don't follow this millat of people who have no iman. Right? Now, in the other ayah also, he talks about millat. And I follow the millat of Ibrahim and Ishaq and Yaqub. So this word millat is very, very interesting. This word millat actually means people who are united together by an emotional or spiritual reason. Right? Millat is like, you know, we talk about the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and alhamdulillah, we are the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But all of believers, even today, are on millati Ibrahim Hanifa, on the millat of Ibrahim alayhi salam, because we have that emotional and spiritual connect. which goes all the way up to Adam alayhi salam, right? That emotional connection, that's a millat. And he is not saying that everybody is in that millah in any community, right? Maybe in your own family, there might be people on one millat and some people on some other millat. How do you know which millat are you on? Where is your emotional and spiritual connect? Who do you gel with? Who do you actually get? People of deen or people of not deen, right? That matters. Who would you rather be with? Who would you rather spend time with? Who do you feel emotionally about? Allama Iqbal talks about millat a lot. Ek hu Muslim haram ki paasbani ke liye, neel ke sahil se leke, tabakha ke khakashgar. What does that mean? That I am this one believer and I am with whichever geographical part of the world I'm from because I have this emotional connect. A lot of times people say that what difference does it make what is going on in Palestine, what is going on in Syria, what is going on in China, in certain, you know, certain places where people get very, very emotional about other people who you don't know. It is this millat. This is this attachment of millah that you have. And it's a very special thing to have. And for you and me to judge what am I upon is to see where my loyalties lean towards. What are the stories that I read in the media that make me emotional and unhappy and sad? And what are the stories that I can relate with immediately? Are those the stories of, you know, whatever, dunya or whatever? Or are those the stories of something to do with our deen, something to do with righteousness, something to do with haya, right? Do I relate to that immediately? You know, sometimes you read stuff and you're like, doesn't that happen? Sometimes some post comes and then you want to immediately share it as well because that connects with you, right? So this millat is a very important thing. And Yusuf alayhi salam is saying that I am on this millah. I do not prescribe, I do not hang out with those who don't have any iman. And another very interesting point that scholars say is that there are two things that he's talking about in these ayat, right? One is that he's saying they don't have iman in Allah and no iman in the akhirah. So what scholars say is that the personal experience Yusuf alayhi salam has had so far about prosecution at the hands of people, they were all of those people whose iman in the akhirah was very dodgy. Because iman in the akhirah is also one thing that stops us from sin. Because you know that there will be a day where I am going to be accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other very cool thing that scholars point out in ayah number 38 is that Yusuf alayhi salam is talking about shukr. Where is he? He's in prison, right? All these guys are also in prison, right? And he's saying that, وَعَلَى النَّاسِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَشْكُرُونَ. Like, Allah's favor upon us is there, but most of humanity doesn't even appreciate that or acknowledge that, have no shukr on that. So shouldn't he be talking about patience and sabr in a place like prison because you're confined? Yeah. But no, he's talking about shukr, right? This is so amazing. And this amazing contrast that we see in this surah. We talked about sabr before. He's talking about that shukr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken us away from a much greater fitna and put us in a confined space. So we should have shukr for that rather than, you know, having kufr of it and rather than saying that, why has this happened to me? Yeah. And Yusuf, Yaqub alayhi salam talked about sabrun jameel. Remember, we discussed that a lot, right? It is something which is most beautiful, sabrun jameel, but most people don't understand that sabr is actually beautiful. So that it's a such beautiful ayat, the language that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses in the Quran, right? So every time we feel some constriction, do shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Perhaps this is for my own good and I don't understand, right? And this millat is also extremely important in our lives. Then Yusuf alayhi salam says in ayah number 39, Ya shahibati, right? And how is he addressing them? In a very beautiful, oh, my fellow prisoners, he's being one of them. He's not putting himself on a righteous pedestal and introducing himself as, hey guys, so me, Yusuf, prophet, you prisoner. No, not at all. He's saying, oh, my fellow prisoners, right? Are different gods better? Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one, the all dominant, right? Allahul wahidul qahhar. So he is beginning his dawah like he did before. Always, always, this is amazing dawah technique with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think there's a song for kids as well, A is for Allah, something like that. Always begin with Allah. Call is always to Allah. Call is not for anything else, but to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because once you understand the significance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything else falls into place. Then you don't have a problem putting on your shebang in 40 degrees heat and walking out in the sun. You have no issue in that because you get Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Wahidul Qahhar. If you don't get that, you're always going to be like, why this and why? Because you see, our deen is not a fiqh manual. It isn't. It is based on the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obedience with love has got this amazing beauty and quality. Although Allah's mercy is such that if obedience is even without love, then you're still rewarded. That is the mercy of the merciful, right? So what he's saying is that, and again, please remember that these are also slaves. These two are also slaves who he's talking to. So he's saying that, and they know the significance of a master. So Yusuf alayhi salam is saying, is it better to have many masters or is it better to have one master? We all know the answer to that, right? So he's asking this beautifully, this rhetorical question. And also they are apparently in a misfortune at that point in time because they are in jail. So he's saying good fortune and misfortune are both from the same Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who's Al-Wahid. There is this concept in some religions that, and even a lot of times people ask people of deen, etc., that how is, if Allah is Rahman and Rahim, then how can he tolerate so much zulm? How can he tolerate, you know, children are raped, such terrible situations happen in this dunya. They don't understand the situation. Fortune and misfortune is both from the same Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what wisdom he has behind the misfortune, we have no clue. And perhaps we won't have any clue either. And these are signs for humankind to learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wahid. There is no good God, God of the good and God of the bad. It's just one God, Al-Wahid. And Al-Qahhar is another beautiful name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who dominates over everything, right? The one who is completely in charge of everything. The one you cannot escape from. The undeniable, the irresistible. These are all meanings of Al-Qahhar. And the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to contemplate on his different characteristics and all of the characteristics that he has, some we know, most of them we don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't just have 99 names or 99 characteristics, by the way. That is something that he has revealed to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much more expansive than counting something on in numbers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rahman, Rahim. And that is what he has chosen for himself, the way he deals with his creation, is with his rahmah, with his mercy. But don't ever forget that he is also Al-Qahhar. He's also Maliki Yawmiddin. He is also Zal-Jalali Wal-Ikram. Because if you only think that Allah is only merciful and only soft, most certainly that quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that characteristics overrides his ghadab. But the fact is that the ghadab is there. He's also Al-Qahhar, right? So important to do. Yesterday somebody mentioned that she goes over the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a wonderful thing to do, right? So, and then he says in ayah number 40, Yusuf alayhi salam is continuing with his dawah. And he's saying, whatever you are worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's just names that you have made up yourself, right? So whatever deities, physical deities as well, yeah, they're just names that we have made up ourselves. So if you say today, if you look at this verse, that whatever you worship other than Allah, these are just names. If somebody says, I'm an agnostic, if somebody says, I'm an atheist, these are just names. They have no reality. These are literally just names. And you don't even understand that without your understanding, you are worshipping that thing that you're calling atheism and you're worshipping that thing that you're calling agnosticism. That is the tragedy of these ideas and these concepts, right? or something that you call materialism, whatever ism that you look at, these are just names. So we don't, alhamdulillah, worship, say, what were the names of the famous idols at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Completely, Lads and Manats, right? The idols at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Or for example, like the Hindus worship certain idols, what are they called? Ganesh. What else? You know the elephant one is called? That's Ganesh. There's a monkey one as well? Hanuman, or whatever the names are. These are just names. There are quite a few, yeah, but these are just names. Just like that. Atheism, agnosticism, materialism. These are just names. Hedonism. You're headed towards hedonism if you are involved in these ideologies. Yeah. Liberalism. Let's add that to the list. Right? Liberalism. Enlightened liberalism. Yeah. It's more like it. Yeah. These are all just names. Mean nothing. Right? You and your ancestors have just made them up. All of these philosophies, which are ungodly, are a creation of a twisted mind, unfortunately, which is under the influence of shaitan, right? So sometimes when you read ayats like these, always relate them to our reality, because that is what it means, right? So it's because sometimes you might think, oh no, but we don't worship whatever. And for us, a large part of our country, Pakistan and in India even, etc., for Muslims, for believers, our idols are lying down. We actually worship graves. We actually worship graves. Abdullah Shah Ghazi Rahmatullah Alayh must have been a very righteous man. He never said that, make this thing on top of me and then, you know. Yeah, and they say that he's the one who is responsible for Karachi not getting a tsunami wave or whatever, right? So these are things that we have just coined up. Somebody said that a person from across the border, that we worship idols that are standing up and you worship idols that are lying down. It's 100% true. 100% true. We know the whole, it's actually a spiritual racket to make money out of innocent people, really. But the innocent people should also have some akal, na? Allah has given you some akal. Who are you going to go to when you are in need? To Ghaus Pak? Ghaus Pak is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And Data Ganjbakhsh is somebody who gives, who has the keys of all treasures. Who has the keys of all treasures? Allah subhanahu. So this is not even hidden shirk, this is manifest shirk. This is manifest shirk. One might think, nah, because you see, atheism, agnosticism are fancy words from fancy universities and all, right? Ghaus Pak. Simple. Yeah, look, think about, and no different. Whatever you are bound down to, whether it is culture, whether it is your own nafs, that becomes your God. And it has no worth. It has no reality other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are just made up names by us and by people around us. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from this manifest shirk and also from the hidden shirk, which is inside of us, right? So Allah has sent down no authority for them. Sovereignty belongs to none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Simple message of Tawheed he's giving. Simple message of Tawheed. He has ordained that you shall not worship anyone but him. This is the only right path, but most of the people do not know. Aksaran nasi la ya'lamun. And this is true of even today in 2022. Aksaran nasi la ya'lamun. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among those who at least have some ilm of Tawheed. Simple, basic. And see, he's using, you know, we are sitting over here because we are speaking in English language and we have these ideologies around us. So you can talk about it. But say, for example, you're talking to your staff. You're not going to talk about atheism or agnosticism. That's not their reality, right? You're simply going to talk about the mazar. You're going to talk about, you know, that why is it that you need to, you know, because sometimes, you know, that's a very, very serious problem. I mean, recently there's somebody who was saying, please give me so much money because my mother is sick and I have to take her to Abdullah Shah. People are very serious about, educated people are like that. I'm not talking about only people who are uneducated, but very educated people are also, when they get into this trap of, you know, whatever mazar worship, it's a serious, serious problem. Yeah, it's promoted everywhere. There is a Wiqaf department of the government. What else can one say? It has government sanction, right? Yes. Absolutely. Yes.
When we're trying to love the people instead of going direct to the negative, like come around.
Absolutely. That's a beautiful thing. Iman has shared that one thing that she got from these ayat was that how Yusuf alayhi salam is leveling with these guys, right? He's being from amongst them and he's giving them hope. He's not saying that, oh my God, you do shirk, you're going to go to hell. Right? So alhamdulillah, this is a beautiful, beautiful da'wah technique. Begin with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Call is only to Allah, nobody else. Sometimes when we begin with issues, even with our own children or even with our own friends, we get into trouble because you haven't introduced Allah and you're talking about why are you going out without covering your head? She doesn't get it. She's not going to get it, right? Or any other issue that you can think of. Start with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Start with that He's Al-Wahid, He's Rahman, He's Rahim. This is a beautiful way to begin, right? And then this feeling that I am from among you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us this idea in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam. In the entire Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the prophets, it's always, they were from among you. They were always from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the extent used to say, once he walked in, then the Sahaba stood up for him. Right? It was just a gesture of respect. And he said, don't stand up for me like the Ajamis do. Meaning what? Don't give me any distinctive position. He didn't like that. He didn't like that. And that is one thing also, sometimes you wonder, that who should I get my deen from? Right? One little small litmus test is that wherever you, alhamdulillah, there are so many avenues today, online as well as in person, where people are teaching deen, teaching Quran, etc. Most certainly go, because this is not something that you can learn sitting at home on your own. That is one thing. One little thing is, see who that person is calling to. Is that person calling you to God, to Quran, to Sunnah, or is that person calling you to a group or to a specific something, or to themselves, right? Or are they very, very keen on that you come and you kiss their hands on their finger or whatever and do whatever or put that money over there and etc. That's going on. So do find out. That'll give you a very little bit of an idea of where you're going. Sometimes, and it is a very right concern as well. Don't just blindly go. There's a class I used to be involved in big time, and I always used to say to the moms that please ask us what we do. Ask us what we're doing with your girls. Are we making them terrorists? And believe it or not, Quran has that power. Not to make terrorists, please, that's not what I'm saying. Quran has that power that somebody, you know, because we are desperate, our hearts are at unrest without the words of Allah. And sometimes we are desperately looking. And in our desperation, whoever is even pretending to bring us close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we start trusting that person. And that person can brainwash you big time. Truly. You know, you'll be eating out of their hands. So be very careful about that and do ask questions. This is not a problem at all. Shouldn't be a problem. So then Yusuf alayhi salam goes on to say, oh, my fellow prisoners, one of you, now after he's done his dawah bit, right, that he has, and how did he go on and on? So now, okay, let me tell you about this. No, simple, straightforward, talking about tawheed, talking about shirk. First things to address and giving them hope, right, and being one of them. And then he continues with the same tone, oh, my fellow prisoners, right? One of you will serve wine to his master, while the other will be crucified and birds will eat from his head. Destined is the matter you are asking about, right? So then Yusuf alayhi salam tells them the ta'wil or the interpretation of the dream. Yeah. And then Yusuf alayhi salam said to the one whom he believed likely to be released out of the two, tell your master about me. Then the shaitan made him forget to tell his master. So Yusuf alayhi salam remained in prison for a few years, right? He told the dream, and then Yusuf alayhi salam had a pretty good idea of who is the one who will become a wine server. And most probably, scholars say it was the one who was the wine server. Most probably it was the one, right? So what scholars say is that this is not against the tawakkul of Allah to seek help of others. He's saying to the one, not the other one, tell your master about me. So one would say that, why is he saying that? Why isn't he just directly asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Does he not have a tawakkul now to Billah? He's a prophet of God. So, and scholars also give this example that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was returning from Taif, remember that was a very difficult and very painful journey for him. And by that time, the Quraysh had planned to murder him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And in the tribal system, the thing was that if you were under the protection of a chief, then nobody could touch you. So in that situation, coming back to Makkah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam took the legitimate help and took the protection of a mushrik, of a leader who was a mushrik. Was that tawakkul against? Was that against tawakkul? No, absolutely not. Getting fair and square legitimate help is not against tawakkul. And we all need that. Even the prophets, from the prophet's example, we see that. From Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and over here to Yusuf alayhi salam. Because sometimes if we have something which Dr. Israr Ahmad, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy with you, used to call taqwa ka haiza. What is haiza in English? Dysentery, yeah. If you have a diarrhea of taqwa, if you have an overdose of taqwa without thinking, yeah, then you become like that, right? That, oh, tawakkul, I can't ask anybody for anything. I'm just going to ask God. Yes, of course you ask God, but this world runs on asbab, right? So you need to have that as well. Alhamdulillah, we all help each other. We all help each other understand the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, right? Is that against tawakkul? No, it isn't. It is in fact sunnah to do that, right? So this is something important to understand in this ayah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say in ayah number 43 that one, now cut to this scene. So what has happened? Those two are out. One has been crucified. The other is serving the king. So he's back in the service of the king. So all of that has happened. And where is Yusuf alayhi salam? Yusuf alayhi salam is still in prison. Achha, before we go on to this verse, one thing which is important over here is that Yusuf alayhi salam is giving them the ta'bir of their interpretation without asking for anything in return. He's not asking for anything in return. The only thing he says to that man is that if you can mention to your master, and that's it. And we are going to see that later on as well when he interprets the dream of the king, he doesn't ask for anything. He just interprets it. He doesn't say that I am going to give the interpretation on the thing, that on the condition that you get me out of prison first. That take me to the king first, then I will give the interpretation. He doesn't say that. No? He does the interpretation, right? And that shows again that righteous people have no personal agendas going. And because we have become so mercenary generally as humankind today, that we find it very difficult to swallow. Why would anybody do me a favor without asking anything for themselves? Without asking for anything in return? I don't ask you for anything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has beautiful, beautiful ayat in the Quran which talks about righteous people who feed people and who help people. And all they say is that we don't even want thank you from you. We want nothing. We only want the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We only want maghfirah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's it. Fee sabilillah. For the sake of Allah alone. Right? Alhamdulillah. Right? So whenever, alhamdulillah, these are the days where perhaps our charity is more than usual, don't ever expect thank you. And if you're expecting thank you, then think about why you're doing this. Whether it is talking to people in way of helping them or actually giving something in terms of charity or anything, or just being there for somebody. Are you expect, or you're sending iftar. So you're expecting, so okay, so I sent this iftar from, I don't know, you know, some fancy place, whatever. And then, oh my God, they didn't send anything. Dekho, kitne roze guzare. Abhi tak kuch nahi aaya, right? So then don't send it, na? Then why are you doing it? But like I said, we have become mercenary in our relationships as well. Right? People get married and people make lists of gifts. So-and-so gave this, so-and-so gave that, so-and-so. You know, so that you can return back the same amount. Making a list to remember in terms of saying thank you is one thing. But if the intention is that they gave up to 101 rupiah, koi bhi nahi deta share, 100 and whatever, they gave like 1,000 rupees, so now I have to give like 2,000 rupees. That's so calculated and crass, really. So it's like that. Yusuf alayhi salam wants nothing. He just wants the best for people. That's it. Nothing else. And that is a sign. He's a prophet. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never wanted anything in return. The Sahaba never wanted anything in return. Right? And generally people who are not of that mindset don't understand that altruism at all. They always have this thing that there's something, some hidden agenda that I'm not understanding right now. You know? So you are having a Quran close, but you're not even taking any money for it. You know? What's up? What is the agenda? No, perhaps the agenda is that somebody is simply trying to follow the sunnah. That's the only agenda and nothing else. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among those who rise above our base self and this mercenary attitudes that we have towards others and truly, truly become people of giving. Giving ourselves, giving our time, giving our skills and our energies to those who need it, inshallah. And only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fi sabilillah, and only worried about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's acceptance, whether this has been accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. Right? Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun, wa salamun ala al-mursaleen, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahumma rabbana ja'alna minhum, alladhina amanu wa amilu shalihat, wa tawasaw bil haqqi, wa tawasaw bil sabr. Ameen, ya rabbil alameen. Ya Ghafurur Rahim, Ya Arhamar Rahimin, Ya Zal Jalali Wal Ikram. Assalamu Alaikum wa Rahmatullahi wa Barakatuh. One announcement, particularly for those of you on Zoom, whoever somebody has left, you can post it, is that it would be really, really useful for us, inshallah, if you guys share your names and your addresses, because inshallah, inshallah, at the end of the session, we would like to give you guys a little token gift. And for those of us who are sitting here, alhamdulillah, it's easier. But those of you on Zoom, we don't want to not include you in this because you are very much part of these sessions, inshallah. So please help us out over here and give your names and your addresses if you are in Karachi to Ruhefa. Jazakallahu khair. And better still, come on the last day so that we have some idea of how many packets to have. Okay? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is a cultural thing. John, it's a cultural thing. Can you imagine? You even, for example,
mothers don't tell the daughters.